Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Grow Grow podcast. I'm your host, as always, Kyle Quinn. And joining me again today is Tom Simpson from the Ed podcast. Good to have you back on, Tom.
Yeah, thanks for having me on. Thanks for having me this week and not last week against Liverpool. Much better chat. Well, supposedly a better chat this week. Last week would have been a tough one, but to discuss 3 points, better than last week, definitely.
Yeah, it was a solid performance. Something positive to talk about, but we're not getting too carried away, are we?
I think that's hard. We definitely have to sit back and enjoy the win. It's been a while since we've had a win, so you definitely do have to enjoy it. But as we were just saying a little bit off air, last week the 5-0 defeat was only 5 or 6 days ago. Definitely still very fresh in the memory and still very, very real what happened. Yes, very exciting. Well, not very exciting, but very enjoyable win against Tottenham. But yeah, you're completely right in saying, not that the paper's over the cracks, we do know that, but the wounds are still very fresh from what happened last, not only last week, but maybe the last month. Nothing sort of wipes that away. So still a lot to work on and a lot to discuss.
Yeah, well, Ollie decided to adopt a 3-5-2 formation, and it worked well. We got the result. They were solid at the back, and they were able to create chances with Cavani and Ronaldo up top, who worked really well together. Like, I mean, I've been calling for Cavani and Ronaldo to play together for weeks and weeks now, and finally Solskjaer decided to try it out, and it was like watching York and Cole for that second goal. Remember York and Cole in the Nou Camp all those years ago? That's what it reminded me of.
Well, I think it was a very similar comparison into that little sort of dinked in ball in behind. But I think we talk about Ronaldo and we talk about his relationship with Mason Greenwood and what he'll bring Mason Greenwood. And on the pitch, they just quite haven't had the same connection. They're almost playing a similar game. They don't quite complement each other. Whether that improves, time will tell. So they haven't quite linked up quite well, but this is the first time we've properly seen. I know they've been on the pitch at the same time, Ronaldo and Cavani, but it's been sort of chasing the game and just throwing everything forward. This is the first time we're able to see them actually play together. And they looked well. They looked on the same wavelength. Now it's just a matter of, well, we'll see if Ollie sort of looks to it in the future, whether this is a consistent thing where he'll fit two strikers in the system, or whether in a few weeks when maybe results sort of start to ease a little bit, if he goes back to a normal sort of 4-2-3-1. And one of them, well, I say one of them will have to be dropped. It would be Edison Cavani who will have to be dropped. But they linked up very well, and I completely agree with you. Like, I've been calling for them to start together, but also had concerns on how does that happen. So I wasn't really criticizing Solskjaer for not doing it, but it was fantastic to see, and almost the last throw of the dice for Solskjaer because his job was on the line. Well, he's on the line pretty much every week now. So it was good to see him go for it in terms of throwing two up front.
Yeah, the problem is he had to kind of drop Rashford and Greenwood from the side, to make that happen, because you're obviously playing wing backs rather than wingers. I thought Luke Shaw had an improved performance last night, and Wan-Bissaka defensively brilliant again. But going forward, he's in a lot of great positions, found himself in a lot of space, but was crossing the ball behind people. He just doesn't quite have the quality in the final third.
Yeah, no, I wouldn't agree. I wouldn't argue. I think it's one of those things. I think he looks a lot worse going forward than he actually is. I think I remember that pass in terms of that one cross was behind. And yes, I think when we do sort of watch all the highlights and watch the other teams around the league, we see Trent Alexander-Arnold probably the best attacking fullback in world football, probably in terms of his delivery. So there is, we don't like to say it, but there's probably a little bit of jealousy when we see that compared to Wan-Bissaka. But it is a balance in that because Wan-Bissaka defensively is outstanding. You just look at that tackle he made back on Son. Okay, he was offside, but Son wasn't to know that. Wan-Bissaka wasn't to know that. Defensively, I think he's fantastic. Surely he has work to do, but he's still a young defender. Attacking, I think he's improving. I think he's showing the right intents to go and improve. He's adding things to his game. Now, ultimately, he's not a prime Gary Neville or Patrice Evra, but I think he's improving. And I think it was an interesting sort of performance for Wan-Bissaka because it was a different role for him. Solskjaer said, okay, this is a must-win job, big game. You're not going to play your normal right-back position. I'm going to ask something completely different for you, completely different from you. And he did that and he performed very well. So you have to give full credit to Wan-Bissaka. I thought he was up there for one of our best performers.
Yeah, I think he did really well, but if we were going to play this 3-5-2 system going forward, or certainly more often, I think we need more of a wing back. That's where Kieran Trippier would have came in if he'd have been signed. I don't think Sancho is defensively good enough to play as a wing back, so we probably will have to persist with Wan-Bissaka, but I don't think he's ideal for that position.
Well, you look when Telles came in for Luke Shaw and, okay, different left back instead of left wing back, but he came on and sort of challenged him. Luke Shaw rose to the occasion. You look now, but maybe not so much Harry Maguire, but what Rafael Varane has done for Victor Lindelof. Lindelof maybe stepped up a little bit, and we've always made that case on the right-hand side. Well, Aaron Wan-Bissaka just doesn't have any competition. I know Diego Dalot's there, but really, but Aaron Wan-Bissaka plays every single week. There's no real competition in Solskjaer's mind there. So that you can completely understand the links with Kieran Trippier in the off-season. And obviously, I think that just came down to a financial decision. I think he was going to cost a lot of money for a so-called, not backup right back, but sort of not a guaranteed starter. That was a lot of money. So, yeah, Wan-Bissaka definitely needs sort of challenging for his spot. And look, I think the club also need to look at that now as well. Solskjaer's position. Okay, they need to look into the transfer market and say, okay, if a new manager comes in, what's he going to see with this one right back? Is there an option to go and get someone else and sort of force Solskjaer's hand into buying a right back in the, whether it be January or next summer, if he's in the job by then?
Yeah, well, of course, Diallo, after his performance against Villarreal, I can see why Solskjaer is not a fan of him. One of the worst performances by right back by a United team, by a United player at Old Trafford, since probably one of Gary Neville's last few games at the club, where he was a bit kind of 36 and overweight. It was really poor. And Diallo, it just offers nothing defensively.
I think that's the thing. It's that balancing act. If you combine the two and get Diallo's quality on the ball going forward, fantastic. But then you sort of miss up that. And what happens defensively for Diallo? It's one of those that's why we've been so blessed in previous years with a Gary Neville or Patrice Evra or Dennis Irwin, who have both sides of the game. Unfortunately, we've got two players with only one side of the game. They've both got good sides for the game, but obviously the other side does let them down a little bit, which look to make that next step and be the best team in the world. You do need that better fullback. At the moment, though, yeah, I think there's more pressing issues in the team than fullback for us.
Yeah, so we saw Rafael Varane come back into the side and straight away it had a very calming influence on the team. He'd never put a foot wrong. He was making interceptions. He reads the game really well, and he makes the others around him better too. He's just the best defender we have at the club by a mile, and we can't really afford to do without him. And yeah, I hope that he stays fit for the rest of the season.
Look, if he's fit, look, I'm not going to say, we're going to go win a trophy or something if he stays fit. It's obviously a team game, but the difference he did make was unbelievable when you do look at it. In terms of, and Harry Maguire and Victor Lindelof, look, they'll draw better performance. They couldn't play worse than what they did against Liverpool. But you do have to look at the influence Rafael Varane did bring and how that sort of does impact those around him, not only those in terms of the defenders, but I thought he gave a little bit more, I wouldn't say protection, but a bit more confidence to Fred and McTominay to be a little bit more front foot and a little bit going forward, knowing that they've got a little bit more protection behind them. So yeah, Rafael Varane, and not only in terms of the way we defended and played, which I think Rafael Varane obviously sort of improved, set pieces the last couple of weeks have been dicey. We've been conceding set pieces. And since Varane has come in, he gets his head on a lot of set pieces defensively. And I thought against Tottenham, they had one or two dangerous positions. But he's got an uncanny knack of attacking the ball, and not in terms of a dominant way, not in Nemanja Vidic sort of going through people, heading the ball, but he just has a knack of being in the right position at the right time, and that is something our defence definitely needs. So it was brilliant to have him back. We do look at Ronaldo and Sancho and these signings. That's great. I think a lot of us deep down did know when Varane signed that he was going to be our most important signing.
Yeah, I'm not surprised that he's most important signing because, I mean, defensively, particularly at centre-back, we weren't great last season. And bringing in a world-class player like him certainly makes all the difference. I mean, we've seen Liverpool have Virgil van Dijk, and what a difference he made to them. It brought them closer, well, along with Alisson, brought them closer to winning the league and the Champions League.
Would you say, I just had a discussion on my podcast, would you say, and I'm not putting him in the same category as a Ronaldo influence, but in terms of if Ronaldo's playing up against a defender, that defender sees Ronaldo in the tunnel before the game and thinks, geez, this is Ronaldo, this is going to be a tough game. Do you think Varane almost has that influence now where someone in the English Premier League is going up against Varane thinking, geez, this is the guy I've been watching in the Champions League for 10 years, lift Champions Leagues, lift World Cups, and he's almost got that influence of authority over the opposition strikers? Because Harry Kane, he looked like a schoolboy against Rafael Varane. Varane just had this presence over him.
Yeah, 100%, because you'd rather play against Maguire, Lindelof as a striker, because they've been ridiculed in the English media for so long. When you've got this kind of defender who has a legendary status in European football, you know, standing next to you, you will be intimidated. So 100% see what you're saying there.
Yeah, no, look, as I say, like, Maguire and Lindelof deserve credit that they played much better. They couldn't have played worse. Everyone played much better, but you do have to not put it all down to Rafael Varane, but when you do see the evidence between the two games, the Liverpool and the Tottenham performance, a lot of it, I think, does come down to the calm and influence and sort of dominating influence Varane did have.
Yeah, I'm so, so glad to see him back. So what do you think of Fred McTominay last night? Because we had the three center defenders, like you said, they were able to have more freedom to get forward. Certainly, it helped them. And do you think that 3-5-2 is a way going forward, especially with regards to McFred?
It's hard. Look, at the end of the day, they played well. I thought McTominay had a very good game. I thought Fred was good for Fred. And look, he had a decent performance. On another day, his shot from 30 yards goes into the top corner, and we're talking what a performance and what a goal by Fred sort of thing. But I thought Fred was solid. McTominay, I thought, had a very, very good game. But in terms of going forward, yes, there's no doubt you need better quality in midfield in terms of moving forward as a team and as a club. But at the moment, the position we find ourselves in, and we can't hide from the fact that we're at rock bottom. Rock bottom manager, players, fans. Solskjaer obviously trusts them, whether we agree with that trust or not. Solskjaer, he's the manager and he trusts them and he threw them back in there. Ultimately, Pogba was suspended as well. And are you going to throw Donny van de Beek in after not playing for, 6 months? You're not going to throw him into a must-win game sort of thing. So you can understand, while I disagree at some stages when he does it, you can understand Solskjaer's persistence with picking McTominay and Fred. And look, they didn't let him down today. They performed well. And you have to give them credit. It's obviously, in my opinion, not the way forward when we're going for Champions League titles or Premier League titles. But against Tottenham, they performed well. They're better than the Tottenham midfield. And if your midfield performs better than the opposition, 9 times out of 10, you're going to win.
Yeah, I do think in the short to medium term, you know, if we're going to play Fred McTominay, maybe he should persist with the 3-5-2.
But they did seem a bit more confident. I don't know. I think, in my opinion, it was because they had three behind them, and maybe that comes down to Rafael Varane as well. But they did just seem a little bit more confident, even showing for the ball. McTominay sometimes, I love McTominay, but a big criticism I have of him is when we're playing out from the back, he can hide from the ball a little bit, doesn't want to go pick it up. But with those one or two extra options, I think he was a little bit more confident getting on the ball. And a lot of it, as you say, I think maybe does come down to that three at the back, whether Solskjaer persists with that. Time will tell.
I just want to mention again that Sancho was an on-new sub. The biggest signing of the summer in terms of transfer fee, 73 million. If Solskjaer wanted to sign him for at least 18 months and now he's not using him, wouldn't it have been better if he'd have spent that money on Declan Rice? You know, because we badly need a midfielder who's top goalie.
Yeah, no, look, it's hard to argue in terms of what we're seeing now and especially the situation we find ourselves in. However, and look, I agree. However, I look at it and think, well, say we had a good start to the season, we wouldn't be reverting to a 3-5-2 at this stage of the season. We'll be playing well. We'll be playing 4-3-3. And Sancho might have one or two goals in his first game, first couple of appearances. That changes his confidence. And suddenly he's starting right wing or left wing type thing. It didn't play out that way in the first couple of weeks. And now we find ourselves with a change in shape and no winger. Now, I think he's still young. It's still early in sort of his United career. And look, we said that about Donny van de Beek at the same stage last season type thing. So hopefully it doesn't go down that path. But it's still early days for Sancho. And I'm sure in whether it be 2 games or 6 games, we won't be using this 3-5-2 system. We will revert to sort of a system which does accommodate wingers. Fingers crossed Sancho does get a run. It's frustrating at the moment. I share everyone's frustrations. No, I think there is a future for him and he will get a run in the team. Unfortunately, at Manchester United, sometimes you don't get that run in the team for a while and you get a very limited opportunity to sort of take your chance when it does come. When it does come, he will have to take it. And that's the cutthroat business of playing for Man United.
Yeah, so it was a really, really good win and pleasing to get one for the first time in the league since we played West Ham away in mid-September. Yeah. But I can't say that I'm confident going into the next game or the game after that. I still think Atalanta away is going to be a tough, tough fixture. You know, they could have blown us away in the first half at Old Trafford. And we got away with one. And the second half performance was really good from the attacking point of view. But away from home is going to be a different ballgame. And obviously Manchester City at home, after we've seen what Liverpool did to us, I dread to think what score it could be against City.
No, look, I completely agree. And regardless of what Atalanta did to us in the first half, the other week, any away game in the Champions League, especially away in Italy, is going to be tough. Even if we were flying, it's going to be a tough game away in Italy, let alone they are a very good team. So I think he will stay with us for the matches to solidify that midfield in terms of the way they did walk through us the other week. And you do look at the Manchester City game, and yes, even if we play very well, even if we have almost our performance of the season, Manchester City could still perform well and beat us quite comfortably. They are a very good team. We don't like to admit that, but that is football. They are quite good. However, could you imagine the reaction if we lost at Old Trafford 2-0 to Crystal Palace? That happened to Manchester City. So they are beatable. I don't know what their defensive situation will be without Laporte, who comes in for him, in terms of they'll be a little bit makeshift. So it will be interesting. Obviously, we'll be missing Paul Pogba. I think Pogba comes in for the Atalanta game. Just for the fact that he'll be missing Premier League games, I think he walks into the midfield. But I share your sort of lack of confidence in regards to the week ahead. However, I wasn't confident going into this Tottenham game and we walk out 3-0 winners. So in football, it's a funny game.
Just on Paul Pogba, I like many fans are just fed up with him. To be honest, he all seems to be flirting with other teams. He won't sign a new contract and it seems as if he's not going to, and he's going to leave for free in the summer. I just wouldn't be against just freezing him out now. I know he's a quality player, but he just doesn't work hard enough without the ball. And he got himself stupidly sent off against Liverpool when we were 5-0 down. Could there be a case for not starting him against Atalanta?
I share all those frustrations. And yes, after the Liverpool game, I didn't accuse him of getting sent off on purpose, but I wasn't happy with him. I thought there was a little bit of that he wanted a way out and he took it. And yes, but then the next week I see his quality and then I think, geez, why are we getting rid of a player with that ability type thing? But I do, especially when you do have to weigh up the balance of the squad and how important Bruno Fernandes is in that advanced midfield role. Sometimes there's always a debate, can Pogba and Bruno play? Sometimes they can, but sometimes when they do play together, we do get exposed a little bit in midfield. So I agree with you in regards to the contract situation. And we as fans should really only be looking at what's happening on the pitch. What happens on the pitch? How are they performing? The contract situation is something that does affect the narrative around things and how he does perform, because you do have to look at, you look at Harry Kane. He wasn't committed last night. He hasn't been committed for Spurs this season because his head's not there. Is Paul Pogba's head at Old Trafford? One week I say it is, the other week I say it's not type thing. And at the moment, I'll allude to sort of it's not, but he's looking away from Old Trafford. And if that is the case, look, there is the case that go freeze him out. Well, when we line up against, I don't know, who's a game coming up at Old Trafford soon, Watford at home, and we have Fred McTominay, and we're thinking, oh, we didn't have enough to break them down after we have a nil-all draw. We'd be saying, shit, was it right to leave Pogba on the bench, or should we have played Paul Pogba for an extra bit of quality? So it's a hard, I do get the frustration with Pogba and say, well, if he's not going to be here next year, don't play him. But I think we do need that quality, especially over the course of a long season.
So how do you feel about Ole Gunnar Solskjaer now? He's still in a situation where he's a bit of a dead duck manager, where he's on game-by-game basis. And I don't think any manager ever survives that. If you are only staying in a job because you won one game, eventually you will lose and you'll be relieved of your duties. Okay, if he beats Atalanta and he beats City, he'll remain. We know that. But what happens if we lose both of those games, or lose one of them and lose badly? Do you think then he'll be sacked during the international break?
I think the international break plays an interesting part in this, because I thought the first thing Monday morning after the Liverpool loss, I thought he was sacked. I thought that they're going to sack him first thing Monday morning. It didn't happen. It'll be interesting dynamic how that international break does play in sort of Conte's availability or Conte's desire to take the job. But in regard, you're completely right in that game-by-game basis, he can't survive that. However, if you do win a couple of games on the bounce and look, overtake Manchester City, qualify out of the Champions League group, it does change things. I'm a huge fan of Ole Gunnar Solskjaer. A lot of people know that. However, I did come to the decision a couple of weeks ago. While I love to see him do well, and I'm a big fan of him, if the better managers out there available, go get him. We need a new manager to take us forward and to make that next step. I think Solskjaer's done a fantastic job, but the moment Sancho, Varane and Ronaldo arrived, Solskjaer's job changed. His job wasn't no longer to get United back on track and challenging. His job was to win things. And the moment he signed his contract in Paris after the Rashford penalty, we all knew that, okay, his job is to get us back, sort of challenge and bring sort of the United DNA back and everything off the field. But the time came when we had to challenge for trophies. There's probably better managers out there. My only question with sacking Solskjaer is, okay, we need a better manager. Go sack him. Who's the new manager? Is it Steve Bruce? Or suddenly, no, you're Solskjaer in. You're keeping Ole Gunnar Solskjaer. Is it Antonio Conte? Well, then, yes, you're bringing in Conte. I've got concerns over Conte, but he's no doubt he's obviously a fantastic manager and he'll obviously bring benefits to the club, but I think he also does bring one or two issues. But it's a hard one. I think ultimately, yes, we do need a new manager. However, if the new manager isn't the ideal replacement right now, I wouldn't be opposed to keeping Solskjaer in and just being a little bit patient. But I do understand the sort of cutthroat nature and frustration and sort of desire for a lot of fans for a change now.
Yeah, Solskjaer was a good man to bring us from like the depths of Jose Mourinho when the club was toxic. And he's been able to bring us to second place. But like you said, once you sign Sancho, Varane, and Ronaldo, the expectations change. And Solskjaer, for me, is not the man to win the Premier League and the Champions League.
And I think that was a little bit harsh on, not harsh, it's the nature of the business. But that happened overnight, those three signings happening, well, the one window, but obviously a quick succession in the window. So he was sort of plodding along very nicely with United. Both manager and both the club were sort of on an upward trajectory. But suddenly the squad expectation went through the roof and Solskjaer was just plodding along nicely. But the squad's expectation just went absolutely through the roof overnight. And look, not harsh, but that's Solskjaer, though, the cards that he was dealt. Unfortunately, might not be the man to deal with that, though.
Yeah, I know we won last night, but he's drowning under the expectations. In fact, we're going backwards again, and that's my concern.
Football's a funny game, though. We go beat Atalanta and get a 3-0 win against Manchester City. It's a funny game. It will change things. Whether it should change things or won't, or whether it should or shouldn't, the fact is it will. People will start thinking differently and treating people differently, so time will tell. Look, it's one of those ones. I'm never a fan. I'm never one to say, okay, I want Solskjaer to lose or United to lose so he can leave and then I can get the manager of my choice. That's not me. I want Solskjaer to go through undefeated. That means Man United to win a trophies type thing. But look, unfortunately, I do share your pessimism in regards to Manchester City this week. It's going to be a tough challenge. But look, Solskjaer has proved when his back is against the wall, he can get these results out of the bag. So, fingers crossed, a little bit of luck this weekend.
Yeah, if he beats Atalanta and City, it'll change things in the mind of the board. But yeah, it doesn't for me, because my problem is we just keep going around in circles. Under Solskjaer, it's been constantly, you know, peaks and troughs. We're never going to win the Premier League or the Champions League by constantly having, you know, upturns in forms and in downturns. We need to be more consistent.
Yeah, no, I definitely agree with that. But it's one of those things, and they say, okay, Solskjaer isn't the man. Okay, we get rid of him. Well, if the club's ideal man isn't available, do we bring in another interim manager until the summer? And then you think, well, do we trust our club with an interim manager where, okay, they can win 10 games on the bounce, let's give them a contract. Then we find ourselves in the same situation type thing. So I do understand and accept and agree with the need for a new manager, in my opinion. I just don't know who that new manager is. I honestly don't know. There are very good names out there, but I think while a lot of them do bring pluses, a lot of those pluses are also accompanied by a lot of negatives. So who's your ideal candidate? If you were to change manager tomorrow, if you could bring any full-time manager, who would you be choosing?
Well, I'll go through the kind of the four names that have been linked the most. Conte, I think he's the most likely to win the Premier League for me. But obviously, he brings issues for the board because he's a combative character. I think in Chelsea, even though he won the FA Cup in the second season, things they dropped off from 94 points to 70. So, and he doesn't stick around too long. I know Inter, he went out after he won the league. I think he was told that they were going to be selling the likes of Lukaku and he walked away. So, he's not a long-term manager, but I think he's the most likely to win a Premier League. Ten Hag, I love the football he plays. He's taken a lot of big scalps in the Champions League. 4-0 win against Dortmund just recently. If Ten Hag and Van der Sar come in together, that would be the perfect duo. But, you know, Van der Sar is not going to take that because he won't have the responsibility at United that he has at Ajax. Who's the other names? Brendan Rodgers. I do like him. I think he's a good, really good coach. He plays attractive football, but Leicester haven't started the season very well. They lost again against Arsenal. He has picked up the FA Cup at Leicester, but ultimately, I don't want to say bottled, but you know they should have qualified for the Champions League twice, and they blew it at the end two seasons in a row. So that would be my concern with Rodgers. Liverpool, we've seen him, you know, not win the league when he was 5 points clear with three games to go. So I was at United, he could come and be top of the league at the start of April, and then not and be second or third in May. That would be my concern. And Pochettino, I'm not convinced by him either. I know PSG is a bit of a poison chalice because there's so many egos in that dressing room to handle. He recently complimented Messi, said he should win the Ballon d'Or and not upset Neymar and Mbappe and their super egos. But he didn't win anything at Spurs. Again, he's another bit of a, he's a nearly man. Him and Rodgers are both nearly men. So he would play good football. But all of them would be an upgrade on Solskjaer, I think. But like you said, there is issues with all of them.
Yeah, I think that's the thing with Antonio Conte. You do see that sort of maybe short-term goal. And that, I think we do need to move away from hoping for the next Alex Ferguson. We do need to look at successful clubs around Europe and around England. And the lifespan of a manager isn't long. It's not 10 years anymore. It's not 26 years. That a successful reign as manager now is 2-3 years. That is the way forward. Whether that's what we as Man United fans want or agree with, that's another debate. But obviously Conte does tick those boxes. But then I look at if things don't work under Conte, and the fact is they might not. You might bring in a fantastic manager and fantastic players. Well, other clubs have fantastic managers and fantastic players. They might have a better season and win. And suddenly you look like you've failed, even if you've done well. So I just look at it and say, if it doesn't go well under Antonio Conte, what state he leaves the club in, I could very well see a situation where he sells Marcus Rashford and Mason Greenwood. And then where are we in terms of we want them to sort of drive the club forward over 10 years and they're suddenly not there? So look, if Antonio Conte walks through the door, I welcome him, but I do have concerns. Pochettino, I share the same. I like him as a manager. I like the way he plays football. It's just you do look at that elite club in terms of winning things with Man United. I think he was in a position to do one or two things with Tottenham, and maybe that mentality maybe did let him, and maybe that changes when he's at a different club. We'll see. Obviously, we'll see what he does this season with PSG. Ten Hag, I really like as well, but then I do look at the situation. Well, if he comes in and loses a couple of games, well, every single fan who's back in his football will say, why are we getting a guy who's only done it for Ajax? What, has he won the Champions League with anyone? We'll be wanting someone of a higher pedigree. And but I do like him, but he obviously comes with sort of limitations. And Brendan Rodgers, I agree, I do like him. But yeah, there are concerns over him at the top level as well. I think he'd be a much better manager, in my opinion, to come in and sort of replace a successful manager so they carry on good work. I think to take that next step, I think he might not be the manager for that. But I think he is a good manager. If we were free-flowing and everything was rosy, I think he'd be very good. Taking that next step when sort of there are so many issues with the club might be a bit of a tricky job. But you mentioned those four managers all have very, very positives, and I'd welcome them all to Old Trafford. But all of them definitely do have concerns, in my opinion.
Yeah, I think if I had to make a choice, it would be Conte because he's the most likely to win the league title. And to be honest, even though he is short-term, just to get another league title on the board would be fantastic. So that would be enough for me to choose him.
Is that a price you would pay? Like in terms of, yes, we all want a trophy. We all want that Premier League or a Champions League type thing. But is that a price you pay? Okay, Antonio Conte comes in and wins the Premier League. However, you do look at, okay, he sells, and this probably wouldn't happen, but let's say hypothetically he sells Mason Greenwood, Marcus Rashford, those type of players, and then we're left with a squad of, I don't know, let's say it was linked under Jose Mourinho, but he brings in Ivan Perisic to replace Marcus Rashford type thing. So when Conte leaves, we've got a 36-year-old Ivan Perisic type thing. Is that a price you're going to pay for a Premier League title? Now, in my opinion, I might do so. I might pay that price. But I also look at Manchester United and think, is that what we should be doing? I'm not quite sure.
Yeah, it's a tough one, but I don't believe that he would necessarily.
Oh, yeah. I don't want to accuse him of something he wouldn't do, but just in my opinion, that's a potential scenario. But just get your thoughts.
Yeah, it would be. I would love a league title, but I'm not sure I would be prepared to sacrifice Rashford and Greenwood. I'm just giving my opinion, but I think Conte would potentially not be a fan of Maguire and Shaw.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah, that'd be, yeah, that'd, definitely. You never know with the manager as well. But like, but there's one thing with Antonio Conte, which I have in the back of my mind. In midfield, I think his two favourite midfielders would be McTominay and Fred, which I'd love to see how that plays with the fans. This new manager come, and he might not. He might sell them both the next day. But in my opinion, I think he'd really like those two. And then we're thinking, well, why are we getting Conte if he's going to persist with these? So, well, time will tell, and I'm sure we'll have answers in a couple of weeks, maybe even after Manchester City. Solskjaer, he'll be out of a job or he'll be back at the wheel. And football is a funny game. We'll have plenty of answers in the next couple of weeks, I'm sure of it.
Yeah, I could see him potentially bringing in a centre-back and a midfielder from Inter Milan, and then his favourite player of all time, Victor Moses. Their right wing back.
well, it's interesting, especially going to the three at the back against Tottenham with the wing backs. It was an interesting throwback to what many people might sort of envisage under Conte. So I think whoever comes in, and especially an experienced manager who obviously sees the problems at United, see the problems in midfield and that defensive midfielder, I think that would be the first on any new manager's transfer list.
It should have been the first priority the summer just passed there. Before we signed anything else, we should have got a defensive midfielder, and we still haven't got one. What a huge mistake that has been. And now we had to revert to back five because of that issue.
Look, yeah, it's frustrating. I'm sure the club, and it's hard. You have to put it all down to the Cristiano Ronaldo deal. And we all sat here and celebrated, and rightly so. And I still think it's a great sign. And I was just discussing then, take away the narrative, take away the story, take away the financials. Just imagine Ronaldo as a new signing in the Premier League. It's been fantastic. He's scoring goals and leading the line for Man United. He's doing very well. But that deal did change, and he wasn't part of the plan. And that's not to say it was a bad deal, just he was not part of the plan, and it did change things, especially financially. And it is the price he had to pay. If we want Ronaldo, well, if we wanted Ronaldo, well, we're going to have to sacrifice that midfield. And now there is a definite strong case, which I would agree with. Maybe we are stronger. You could live with Cavani up front and have a better midfielder type thing. And I definitely agree with that. But we are football fans, and there was something about the romanticism of Ronaldo returning back to Old Trafford, which you had to enjoy. You had to accept, as like we've said with Conte, it's the price you pay. If we wanted Ronaldo and that enjoyment, that excitement, well, the price we had to pay was midfield, unfortunately.
With that performance from Ronaldo last night is exactly why we were happy to see him back at the club, because he was fantastic last night. The goal, the assist, and the finish for the offside goal was absolutely tremendous as well.
Oh yeah, I was gutted that didn't go in. Obviously, the McTominay would have got an assist, but yeah, that finish was, yeah, everyone's forgotten about it, but what a, yeah, absolutely unbelievable hit.
Okay, let's come on to the player ratings now. David De Gea, for once, had absolutely nothing to do. So what would you give him out of 10?
Yeah, well, on my podcast, we do 3-2-1s in terms of man of the match gets 3 points and 2-1, so on. And for the last couple of weeks, it's always been David De Gea. So I was very good to sit back and just not mention his name in regards to man of the match. But yeah, De Gea, not to be arrogant or anything, but did he touch the ball? I can't remember an actual save. Did Tottenham have a shot on target or?
Nope.
Yeah, so I don't know what you can give a goalkeeper there. I assume he's, from memory, his distribution was fine. Actually, he gave the ball away once, in a dangerous position, but nothing to sort of to write home about. So your standard six, no criticism of him at all.
So Armand Bissaka, extremely solid at the back and decent going forward, but not brilliant.
Yeah, I think it's one of those ones that you mentioned, that cross, which I completely agree with, that cross that goes behind. I think if someone reads that, or it's a better cross and he gets an assist, we're talking what a complete performance type thing. So I think one of those, I think he's good. I think when I say an 8 out of 10 out loud, that maybe sounds a little bit too high in my head. However, I think he was crucial to the way we played. So a 7 or 8 out of 10, I thought he was solid. But as you say, in terms of that next step or just wanting something more, he just need to sort of add that extra bit of quality in the final third. But I thought he was good. 7 or 8 out of 10 for me.
Okay, what about Raphael Varane? He's an absolute world-class player. He's a Rolls Royce centre-back. Okay, he wasn't playing against the greatest of opposition last night, even though it was Harry Kane. But, Harry Kane doesn't want to be there anymore. So what do you think of Varane's first game back? What would you give him?
Well, I think you mentioned their first game back as well, which I think is something you have to add to it. We've seen, and not to criticise Harry Maguire, but Harry Maguire's first game back, he doesn't look fit. And I don't think that's something we criticise. I think that's something we can only praise Varane for. It's not a criticism of Maguire. We just have to say Varane to come back from an injury and perform like that, very, very impressive. And again, as you mentioned, probably didn't have too much to do in terms of real defending type thing. So you can't go give it a 9 or a 10 out of performance, 9 or 10 out of 10. But I think very solid. Yeah. If I give him Wan-Bissaka 7 or 8, I think Varane would have to be an 8 as well.
And what about Harry Maguire himself? Do you think he improved on the Liverpool game? Well,
he improved, definitely. But almost along the same lines, I thought sometimes he's definitely shaky with the ball at times, but I think Maguire, even when he's at his best, he's a little bit shaky with the ball. He's not the greatest of footballer. He's a defender first and foremost. So I think I'd almost pair him with Victor Lindelof as solid. I'd say 6 out of 10, but a good 6 out of 10. Just did their job. No, nothing to write home about it, but almost in the category of De Gea. Didn't have too much to do, to be honest.
Was it just a case of strength and numbers last night?
Yeah, it could be. That's always a case. You can sort of label when you do play three at the back. Three at the back or five at the back, however you mentioned that. But there's also the potential when you do play three at the back, the central defenders, you can get dragged into wide areas where especially Harry Maguire doesn't want to be defending in a wide area. So while there are sort of, as you say, strength in numbers in the middle, sometimes if the attacking team does get on the front foot and are quite fluid, you can be dragged into dangerous areas, which do make it tricky for central defenders. So yeah, I take your point and agree. It may be a little bit safer for the defenders, but also they didn't do anything wrong. So you can only praise them, but you can only give them credit for what they did.
So Luke Shaw, he played an incredible ball and he definitely improved defensively last night. But again, it could be down to strength and numbers, but certainly it was an improvement on Liverpool.
Same as much improved. I thought, in my opinion, and not to throw everyone under the bus, I thought he was one of our worst performances against Liverpool. I thought he was a real issue with our performance type in both attacking and defensively, but he improved. So you have to credit to him. I called for Alex Telles to come in for this game, but Luke Shaw performed well. You mentioned the same case in terms of he's maybe a little bit more suited to that role than Wan-Bissaka on the other side. He's got a little bit more to his game. We saw with England how well suited he can be. But yeah, performed very well. Lucas Moura obviously got subbed, and I think he was one of the more dangerous players, which obviously the Tottenham fans weren't happy with. But Luke Shaw dealt with everything. It's a little bit tricky. He got a harsh booking, in my opinion. It was a yellow card, but he was fouled, which sort of changed his sort of dynamic in that second half. But good performance. 6-7 out of 10.
So what about Fred and McTominay? We touched on it earlier that they had more freedom to get forward than they usually do, and it seemed to suit them.
Yeah, you find it hard to have a discussion without just using them as one, as Fred. You'd rate them rather than McTominay and Fred type thing, but I think they both had similar type performances. I think if I was to rate one, and maybe it's a personal bias as a fan of McTominay, I would say McTominay had the slightly better performance. But I think we do, and it's almost right in terms of the role they do play, to pair them as one and sort of rate them as a partnership in midfield. And look, at the end of the day, if your team wins 3-0 in a Premier League football match, your midfield must have done something right. And yeah, I have to give them both plenty of credit. I'd say 6 maybe sounds a little bit low when you go and score 3 goals. Okay, they weren't involved in the goals, but the midfield does sort of set that platform. So maybe a 7, maybe that sounds a little bit too high, but I think a 6 maybe sounds a little bit too low.
Yeah, I think last night we saw a wee bit of the Fred that plays for Brazil with that long range effort that he needs in the top corner.
But then when he does that, he looks like he's got the ability to do that. Like when he strikes the ball, you think, oh, there's a player in there. But then sometimes you see him play a pass with his left foot, and you think, oh my God, what's happened there? So look, he's a weird one, Fred. I'm sure we'll be having many discussions like that until he leaves the club in a couple of years.
Yeah, and then there was that double foul that he committed that he could have got 2 yellows for.
Yeah, 3 yellows in 5 seconds he could have got. Yeah. And I actually thought one of the Tottenham players actually asked the referee about that. He said, hang on, okay, I understand you can only blow for one foul. However, there's an occurrence after the foul as well. You can technically, I don't know, don't have the laws in front of me, but I'm sure he was in the referee's ear to say, okay, that's a yellow, but he's also done another yellow here. So, look, I'm sure he was never in danger of getting sent off, but it would have been a very Fred-like thing to do.
Yeah, I've never seen a player get sent off in that situation, but who knows? I mean, Fred.
It wouldn't shock you.
No. Okay, what about Bruno Fernandes? I think he got an assist for the first goal. Fantastic ball into Ronaldo, who finished the ball like it was like a right-footed Van Persie, that finish.
Yeah.
Glorious. So what did you make of Bruno last night? Much improved.
Definitely improved like everyone, but yeah, definitely Bruno. I think it's weird with Bruno. I think when he gets goals and maybe, okay, this is a great assist, but when he gets sort of multiple assists or a couple of goals, you do look at his performance and you think, well, his performance wasn't that good, but he actually stepped up when it mattered. And I think sometimes when he goes a little bit unnoticed, and I think he did in this one in terms of Rafael Varane stood out, Ronaldo stood out, Cavani stood out, sometimes that helps Bruno and he can just go about his business. And I think what I was most pleased about Bruno, okay, the pass, fantastic, and he was good on the ball. It was his defensive, and maybe it was because he had two strikers in front of him that maybe limited sort of him going to press goalkeepers or press the last line of defence. I think he was far more disciplined in defence. He was really sitting and helping Fred McTominay, so that he was starting a little bit deeper, and I thought he was a much more disciplined performance by Bruno Fernandes rather than, and I don't want to criticise him for the goal against Liverpool, but you do, the image that's burned in everyone's brain from that Liverpool performance is that first 5 minutes where Bruno sprints at the goalkeeper and just opens up the whole pitch for Liverpool. Bruno didn't do that once against Tottenham. I think he's far more disciplined. So great ball, it's a fantastic assist and deserves all the credit for that. And that's why Bruno is in there to provide moments like that. But I thought the most pleasing aspect of his game for me was his discipline in defence.
So what about Ronaldo and Cavani? The first time they started together, and there does seem to be real potential in this partnership, and we really want to see more of it. For me, they were both easily 8 out of 10.
But both would have an 8 for me. And I think the thing with Ronaldo, what can you say? It's exactly what you got Ronaldo for. But Cavani, I was so pleased for him to score. Obviously, we always want anyone to score, but obviously your strikers to score. But I was just looking at cover. It's almost, tomorrow's November. Imagine him going up until November without scoring a goal. He needed a goal. And while he has been playing well and contributing, and you think he should be playing, and we're full of praise for Cavani, I think he's been very good this season. He needed a goal. He needed a goal for his confidence. I think the Europa League final was his last goal type thing. So I was over the moon for the goal and won. One only that, it was a fantastic finish. A nice little dink finish over the goalkeeper. And you can tell how much he does love it. Like the celebrations when, even when Ronaldo scores or Rashford scores, he's first over there. He loves it. But at the end of the day, he is a striker. He lives and breathes goals. He wants the goals for himself. So I was over the moon for him to grab a goal. But his performance, as you mentioned, solid. 8 out of 10. I think the same with Ronaldo.
Yeah, and I think we've really missed Cavani's his work rate off the ball. I mean, there's been lots of talk about players down in tools. Well, I don't know why Solskjaer hasn't played Cavani sooner, because there is one man who will never down tools. He will always give 100% for the shirt.
Yeah, completely right. I think it's one of those things in terms of no matter how bad United can play or how bad the result is, all we can ask for. And yes, as fans, when we're supporting Man United, yes, we do ask for the best quality, of course. However, us as fans, we can't provide that quality. What we can provide, if we ever will give him the shirt, we could provide 100% effort. So that is literally, at the end of the day, all we can truly ask for is 100% effort. And sometimes we don't see that, and that is what sort of sends a lot of frustration towards the players. But as you mentioned with Edinson Cavani, that's one thing you can't label at him. He gives 100%. I think everyone, it was a couple of weeks ago now, but it was Villarreal where he chased that ball down type thing, which was unbelievable. And that is why fans love him. It's a shame that it's taken a few years, or not a few years, but he's sort of arrived at United so late in his career. If you imagine a prime Edinson Cavani, if we had 5-10 years of that type thing, I think he would have been one of United's great strikers.
Yeah, I think we've all said that at some point, that we wish he had signed for United when he was 28.
I never realised, I knew he's a good striker, I knew he scored goals type thing, but I never sort of watched too much of him sort of 90 minutes, so... It was a little bit like Robin Van Persie. When Van Persie signed, I was like, okay, he's good. That's a very good signing. But when you see him play, you think, oh, he's a very good player. And Edinson Cavani, since he arrived at United, I've been very impressed. I thought he was just always a good goal scorer, played in good teams, he scored goals, and thought nothing more of it. But when you actually watch him play and what he brings to the team, I think he's brilliant.
Yeah, the work he does off the ball and his movement off the ball as well are two things I didn't know about until he came to United, just like yourself. So there was impacts from the bench. Rashford easily a 7 for getting a really good goal. Matic providing the assist. He came off the bench. Matic has really got that in his locker, doesn't he?
He's got the last win in London, obviously the West Ham, came off the bench to set up Jesse Lingard. Obviously Jesse Lingard had a lot to do. It wasn't sort of laid it on a plate type thing, but Matic is an interesting one because he's coming in and is contributing now. He'll be interesting if he plays midweek. There's always the debate around Matic. Can he play two games in a week type thing? You can't see him starting against Manchester City. You would assume that would be McTominay and Fred. So there could be a case for maybe rest McTominay and Fred for the Manchester derby. And we had the discussion about Paul Pogba. Let's say Paul Pogba does play against Atalanta. Could be interesting to see if it's Matic and Pogba during the week.
Yeah, I'll definitely give Matic a 7 for that cameo. But regards to Matic and Pogba, were they in at the midfield against Leicester?
And that was look, there's definite concerns if I was playing them too. I'm just thinking what Solskjaer's... But he's also probably going this Atalanta game almost must win as well in terms of trying to qualify for the Champions League. So that he very well might play McTominay and Fred again. But it would be interesting. But I'm a huge fan of Matic. I think, yeah, almost like the Cavani, it would be good if we had Matic 10 years ago and he could almost be that ideal number six we're all craving. Unfortunately, he's not that player anymore, but I think just because he's not that player anymore that we do want, he's still a very good player to have and still offers us a lot. I think a lot of people say, oh, he's too old. Well, no, he's a very good player. We do need to manage him properly, and Solskjaer maybe needs to do not better man management, but does need to get a little bit more out of him in regards to minutes and sort of trust in him over McTominay and Fred. But I think Matic is performing well this season.
Yeah, he's probably a bit frustrated that he's not starting many games. He seems to start the games immediately after the international breaks because Fred is coming back from Brazil and isn't available. Okay, what about the manager? How would you rate him out of 10? Yesterday, obviously, it's going to be a massive improvement again on the Liverpool game.
Yeah, big one, a Liverpool one. But you do have to give him credit. Whatever anyone's opinion on the manager, I don't think long-term should change on this. If you wanted to change your manager before the game, I think that should very well stay the case after this. It doesn't change anything in that regard. However, if you do look at that individual performance, let's say I made the point a couple of hours ago to a mate saying, let's say he did get the sack against Liverpool and Antonio Conte walked in Monday morning. If Antonio Conte changes that team to 3 at the back against Tottenham and wins 3-0, we're all sitting here saying, that's what we've been missing. We've been missing a tactical genius to line up with 3 at the back and go away to Tottenham win 3-0. Well, Solskjaer's just gone and done it. So you have to give him full credit for it. Okay, Tottenham weren't great. We can't hide from the fact Tottenham were poor on the night. But you have to give credits to Solskjaer. And it's not a lot of people said, oh, he only did it because that's what Antonio Conte would have done. Well, Solskjaer in big games does often revert to this 3 at the back. Some of his biggest performances and best results as Man United manager have been with a 3 at the back over the years. So it's something he does have in his locker and something he does revert to and knows what he's doing when he does do it. I'm sure we'll see it against Manchester City type thing. So in terms of rating, you have to say, especially like I said, from rock bottom, it's not just the performance on the pitch. You do have to understand the narrative and pressure that was building, which I think you do have to give maybe an extra point to. I'd be an 8 out of 10 for me. That doesn't change your opinion on wanting maybe a new manager, but in the specific game, you got it bang on.
Yeah, it's not going to change my mind on whether he should be there or not, but it's better winning games than losing games. Yeah. 100%. So what we normally do at this point of the podcast is give our predictions for the next match, but like we've already talked about, it's really, really impossible to know what's going to happen against Atalanta or City. You're obviously probably more confident now after getting a 3-0 win against Spurs that we can get a result in Italy. My calculations are that if we can just get a draw in one of these two away games against Villarreal and Atalanta and beat Young Boys at home, that should be enough to qualify. So a draw, I think, wouldn't be a too bad a result away from home.
Yeah, look, I don't have the table in front of me as well, but I've always been of the same opinion, I think. And yes, that Young Boys defeat at the match day one, it does. Look, didn't destroy United, but it was a little bit of a kick in the teeth to make things a little bit harder. But ultimately, even as I said, even if we were flying under Fergie, going to any team away in Italy is a tough game, and you do have to sometimes take a point. Now, if we do get a draw, you're going to only imagine the reaction. It'll be a nightmare online type thing. But yes, with the next game being at home to Young Boys, maybe it's a good result. And I think it's the manner of the draw. If we are able to maybe rest one or two players ahead of the Manchester derby in terms of key players and keep them fit and you still get away with a draw, you think, well done. But if we go full strength and we have a lackluster or we're 2-0 up and we blow a 2-goal lead type thing, well, that's a different type of draw type thing. So, yeah, in terms of prediction, it is hard. As you say, a lot more confident today than we probably were yesterday type thing. But that's a positive. But the player, not only the fans are going more confident, but most importantly, the players will go in more confident. And I'm confident of a result in Atalanta, whether that be a draw or a win. I'm confident of getting the job done. Manchester City on the weekend is a different kettle of fish. It wouldn't shock me if United go and win. I think in terms of the way football works, I can definitely see that happening. However, if Manchester United play well and Manchester City play well, I just think Manchester City are better. And that's not a criticism of United. Yes, we should have the ambition to be better, of course. But the fact is, at the moment, Manchester City are better. They have a better manager. They've got better players. If they play well, they have a likely chance of winning. But it would not shock me if United go and perform, which, fingers crossed, they do.
Yeah, see, immediately after the Liverpool game where we lost 5-0 and it could have been any score if Liverpool didn't take their foot off the pedal, I was thinking Man City will beat us. They'll be ruthless. It'll be
10-0.
But after one result against Spurs, I'm not thinking that anymore. I think City will
beat us. And they lose 2-0 at home to Palace, which who would have picked that?
I'm thinking City. I still think they'll win, but I think it'll be a narrow win for City.
Do you know who they've got in the Champions League or where they are this week?
Oh, I could just maybe look that up now.
I think they played Bruges last time. I think they might be in Manchester, so they might not have a trip. I think they played Bruges, so I think that's a reverse fixture maybe.
They're at home to Bruges on Wednesday. Nah,
so you'd think they'll play rest a few, so it's probably not ideal for them where we've got a tricky trip to Atalanta. So it's always going to be hard. That's definitely not an excuse if we come back tired or anything. We've got a big squad and they're traveling in first class luxury, but I would have preferred Man City to be away in Turkey or something rather than at home to Bruges.
Although we have got an extra day's rest, if that makes any difference.
Oh, okay. Yeah. No, didn't think of that. Yeah, definitely. We've got the early game, the Tuesday night game.
Okay, we'll wrap it up there. It's been a pleasure to have you on the show again, Tom.
No, always. Just thank God it was after a good win. Make sure next time you ask me on is after a good win, not after a Liverpool 5-0 loss. But always a pleasure, mate. Really enjoy it.
Yeah, the last time I had you on, I think, was when we beat Lee 5-1. So hopefully next time it'll be another big victory.
No, keep that trend going, please.
Okay, see you later.
Thanks, mate. Thanks.